Sir Ralph Friedman describes the Sydney Harbour Bridge on its golden anniversary.
The structural engineering masterpiece of the century.
Mrs. Rosemary Harmer was at the opening ceremony.
Mr. Lang stepped forward with his scissors to cut the ribbon when there was a commotion in the crowd. And a horse came through with a rider, and he rode up to the ribbon and slashed it with his sword.
Dr. Peter Sperrett, a specialist in urban studies.
About 140 million people a year cross the bridge. In other words, the equivalent of the population of Sydney crosses the bridge every 11 days. It's still the main link between north and south.
We're building a bridge in Sydney over the harbour too. Well, only crossing safety and busy trains pass through. A wonderful thing of beauty, crossing the skies of blue. The best brains thought it, brave men wrought it, bridge of our dreams come true.
Captain Cook's Journal, entry for Sunday, 6th of May, 1770.
Abreast of a bay or harbour, wherein there appeared to be safe anchorage, which I called Port Jackson.
After Sir George Jackson, one of the secretaries of the Admiralty far away in the cosseted comfort of Georgian London. Even further from the Cleveland Hills of Yorkshire, which had nurtured a young boy who grew up to become one of the great navigators in that age of enlightenment. Britain lost her American colonies in 1776, and about the same time, one of the developments of the Industrial Revolution was being planned in this valley at Coalbrookdale in Shropshire. Its triumph was the spanning of the River Severn by iron, the first use of the material for bridge building. American independence and British engineering skill were not connected, but both would have their effect in the Antipodes. A decade later, on the morning of Monday, 26th of January, 1788, a fleet of nine chartered merchant vessels, escorted by the Navy ship Sirius, rounded South Head and moved into Port Jackson on the way to join HMS Supply with Captain Arthur Phillip on board at what would be called Sydney Cove. He decided this harbour was preferable to nearby Botany Bay for settling his 736 unwilling passengers after their 8 months' journey from England. As Cook predicted, a fine anchorage indeed. But those inhospitable foreshores were to be the dumping ground for the cargo of convicts, the overflow from Britain's teeming jails, who could no longer be dispatched to the American colonies. Began to expand with free settlers taking up land and convicts being released. It soon became apparent that there were many obstacles to progress. Developments of the prototype iron bridge at Coalbrookdale would have been a blessing in New South Wales, but the material was not yet produced locally, and iron was too expensive and too heavy to ship around the world. The Industrial Revolution put England in the forefront of bridge building during the early 19th century. Mm-hmm. great engineer Thomas Telford designed this suspension bridge spanning the Menai Straits between the Welsh mainland and the Isle of Anglesey, the first bridge over the sea. It was begun in 1820 and completed 6 years later. The span of 579 feet between towers was then also the longest in the world. A young man named David Lennox worked with Telford at Menai. Later, he was attracted to a life of adventure on the other side of the world. Lennox arrived in Sydney Town and worked for a while on the new Parliament House in Macquarie Street, until the Surveyor General heard about him and decided he should supervise the extensive program of bridge works planned for the colony. The first of these was over a deep gully on a new section of the main western road in the lower Blue Mountains. The golden sandstone was quarried near the site by a gang of 20 convicts. And after little more than 6 months, work was completed. By order of the governor, it was named after Lennox and carried most of the road traffic to and from the west for the next 93 years. Since the distant dream time of the original inhabitants until well after the arrival of the Europeans, Sydney Harbour, from the heads to the upper reaches of the Parramatta River, 20 miles away, was difficult to traverse. The Aborigines were probably not worried about this, but the new settlers were. And from the earliest days, the linking of the northern and southern shores was a subject for discussion and speculation. The centenary of Phillip's landing at Sydney Cove came and went bridgeless. And by now, at least 12,000 people were resident on the North Shore. A Royal Commission in 1890, investigating the extension of the railway, was told that 5 million people crossed the harbour annually by ferry, as well as 378,000 vehicles and 44,000 horses. It was a hot and humid January day as more than 150,000 people assembled in Sydney's Centennial Park. The park had won over a harbour bridge as a suitable way to commemorate the centenary of Phillip's landing. The spirit of unity during celebrations to mark federation of the colonies in 1901 took their minds off such things. Precisely at 1 o'clock, the first Governor General, Lord Hopetoun, entered the swearing-in pavilion to take the oath of allegiance as a 21-gun salute boomed out and the Commonwealth of Australia was born on a surge of confidence. At this time, a young engineer from Queensland named John Job Crewe Bradfield was rising rapidly through the ranks of the Department of Public Works. Dr. Peter Sperrett has written extensively about Sydney, past and present.
Well, in the early 1900s in Sydney, you had a feeling that great things were going to happen in Australia. I mean, you had the Federation movement, and following on from that, there was a feeling in the air that Sydney, which had recently overtaken Melbourne in population, was going to be the great city of Australia. And so a lot of people at the time were putting around various plans for the improvement of Sydney. There was a Royal Commission into linking Sydney and North Sydney in 1908, and a Royal Commission into the city and suburbs as a whole in 1909. And during this time, Bradfield is working his way up the hierarchy of the Public Works Department. And suddenly, he comes up with his own scheme for a harbour crossing, and the government, who are really taken with this young, pushy public servant, make him the chief engineer of the city transit branch in 1912, with responsibility for getting a proposal for a harbour crossing through Parliament, in effect.
Bradfield was sent overseas in 1914 to study the latest developments and techniques in England, Europe, and the United States. He cast a professional eye over New York's famous Brooklyn Bridge of 1883, noting that its span was almost exactly the same length as Sydney's needed to be, 1,600 feet. While in New York, he also saw the Hell Gate Railway Bridge under construction. He studied the fabrication of the steel sections in the American Bridge Company's works and examined the methods proposed for its construction, which was completed in 1916 and for 16 years was the longest arch span in the world. But once again, events conspired to halt the Sydney project, although this time it was not bureaucratic indecision. Australia was at war, and by the time it was all over, the young country would have received its baptism of fire against the Turks at Gallipoli, suffered the divisive effects of conscription at home. In all, 55,000 would die, with 167,000 wounded. Those who survived could return to a nation facing the more constructive prospects of peace. Peter Sperrett has written a biography of the Sydney Harbour Bridge.
Bradfield had always had in mind a cantilever bridge, but on one of his early trips to Europe in 1914, he'd seen the Hell Gate Arch Bridge, and it started to dawn on him that the arch bridge was also a possibility. In the meantime, Bradfield, as a public servant, was very disconcerted to find that the Labour government that had given him the go-ahead lost the election. So he then had to turn around and organise a new lot of political support to get his Harbour Bridge Act through, which he did finally in 1922. He put together a remarkable coalition of the Labour and non-Labour parties of the time. The only people who opposed the Harbour Bridge Act in New South Wales Legislative Assembly were the progressives, the country party types who said, why do we want a bridge in Sydney when we need railways out back?
Among the six international companies vying for the big contract was the Cleveland Bridge and Engineering Company of Darlington in the north of England. They engaged the services of the eminent consulting engineer Ralph Freeman, senior partner in the London firm of Sir Douglas Fox and Partners. But then Cleveland's chairman, their driving force, died suddenly, and the remaining directors decided to withdraw from the project. Ralph Freeman, working from London, was able to persuade another company to take over the tender. Bradfield agreed to the change. It was a surprising decision because, although they were respected steelmakers, Dorman Long had never actually built a bridge before. Ralph Freeman prepared seven separate tenders around three basic designs. An arch with granite piers and no pylons, an arch with white concrete piers and white concrete pylons, an arch with granite piers and granite pylons, cantilever arch with granite piers, cantilever arch with white concrete portals and piers, cantilever bridge with granite-faced piers, and cantilever bridge with white concrete piers. A suspension bridge would have cost at least £1 million more. The cantilever designs were not huge by world standards, but the rigid arch was twice as large as any similar bridge built before. Dr. Bradfield reported on 16th of February 1924, a month after all the tenders were received.
I have carefully studied the methods of erection of the arch bridge proposed by Messrs. Dorman Long & Company Limited, and I have no hesitation in advising that a two-hinged arch bridge can be erected by the methods proposed and that the bridge will be safe at all stages of erection.
The construction period was to be 6 years.
A lot of people were claiming at the time that the bridge was going to be largely a product of British capital and British companies, but in fact in the tender specifications the New South Wales government made clear that it should be built by Australian workmen and have as a high percentage as possible of Australian materials. what happened in the long run was that about a quarter of the plain steel and all of the rivets for the bridge came from BHP's recently opened steelworks in Newcastle. We have to remember, of course, at this time that Australia is not really an industrialised country on the scale of Europe, America and England, and that the bridge in a way symbolises the coming of the industrial age to Australia. In the late 1920s, a controversy flared about who really designed the bridge, and it was a public controversy because the two protagonists were Ralph Freeman and Bradfield. But really the controversy about who designed the bridge is a bit of a non-controversy. It depends what you mean by the term design. But arch bridges had been pioneered before this one. It's probably true to say that Bradfield was the person who decided that it ought to be an arch bridge in the final analysis. It's also true to say that Bradfield didn't do the detailed drawings that Freeman and Kerensky and others worked on that side of it.
A young Russian-born engineer just down from Oxford worked on the post-tender designs, Dr. Oleg Kerensky.
At the beginning I was doing what we call donkey work, designing and doing calculations on prescribed limited tasks. As I became more expert and I was pretty fast, I started designing more complicated parts of Sydney. In particular, I was involved in the design of bottom laterals of the arch, which was a most elaborate calculation in those days and required great attention, because if you made a mistake, you had to do it all again. Sydney was breaking new ground, the whole design was breaking the ground. I don't think the individual designers were breaking new ground, I think they were fulfilling tasks. While in London, the three stages were designed, were executed, which is preliminary design, erection procedures, and final design, polishing up everything. Simultaneously, in Middlesbrough, the first stage was testing of steel, then testing of newly designed members, which were unique in their size and in the thicknesses of plates and so on.
The youngest child of England's enterprise, an infant Hercules. That was the description given Middlesbrough by Mr. Gladstone when he visited the fast-growing centre of industry on the River Tees in Yorkshire in 1862. Within the reign of Queen Victoria, it expanded from a sleepy rural community to a paradigm of industrial energy. The city became rich on the iron deposits of the nearby Cleveland Hills, and one of the companies which put the business on a solid base was founded in 1870 by Arthur Dorman and Albert Long. They began in a former farmhouse beside the River Tees and quickly expanded, building rolling mills in what would become the largest steel fabrication plant under one roof in the world. Workers were attracted to the prospect of regular employment in the gritty atmosphere, and they lived in the claustrophobic terraces of ever-spreading suburbs. The district's most famous son was not forgotten in the midst of the soot and the smoke. For the rest of the 1920s, ships much larger than Cook's would make regular journeys from here across the world with their cargoes of steel for Sydney. One of the terms of the contract with Dorman Long was that test models be made of all the principal sections of the bridge. In Middlesbrough, a device was specially built for the purpose called a universal testing machine. It is still in use, and the surviving scale model of a bridge section for Sydney is given a simulated test. Sidney Barlow was the engineer in charge of the tests.
There were a series of tension and compression tests. And on some models, we had compression plus bending. For the tension tests, the models were fitted in the machine with grips at each end, and the machine, under hydraulic power, gradually stretched these models until there was that point of destruction. For the compression tests, it was in reverse, excepting in this case, the machine compressed the member and concertinaed the member. I was in the machine at one time when we were making a test. I think it was 1170 tons test piece at the time. Well, we knew where this was going to go, and we were watching it very carefully. But unfortunately, it broke before its time. I don't remember coming out of the machine.
The Sydney Harbour Bridge is distinctive because of its monumental granite pylons, which have little structural purpose above the level of the deck, but are there, in the words of Dr. Bradfield, to satisfy the aesthetic principle that truth is beauty. Ralph Freeman had thought the bridge would be fine without the stone pylons, but the client was prepared to provide the quarry and foot the bill, which added 1/6 to the total contract price. This provided work for a large number of people near Moruya, a small farming town sitting on a great seam of granite on the south coast of New South Wales. The quarry near the town was in operation for 6 years between 1925 and 1931. Dorman Long employed about 250 men, many of them stonemasons who came from Aberdeen in Scotland, the Granite City. They called their village here Granite Town. Others came from Italy. A store was set up, a post office, assembly hall, and school. Three steamers, each of 300 tons, were specially built to transport the output of the quarry to Sydney, in a constant shuttle service of huge granite blocks to clad the piers and pylons, and crushed aggregate to be mixed with Nepean River sand for concrete. Molly Cook worked in the site office and remembers what life was like for the workers.
Good, I think. I'd say it'd be good. Everybody was friendly. Never heard of any disturbances or, you know, anything like that. And by the time they finished their day's work, those men were tired. You know, it was hard work down the quarry, the labourers and the stonemasons and whatever other job they were doing, crane drivers. It wasn't easy work, and it was a long day. I was clerk, typist. They'd call it Girl Friday now, I think. You were a long way from the actual building of the bridge. But you knew there was going to be something big at the end of it all, which there was.
In Sydney, the first tangible signs of activity indicating that bridge construction had started appeared in early 1925. A massive clearance on either side of the harbour made way for the foundations and the extensive approaches. At first, the site looked like the battlefield of the Somme, alternately muddy and dusty. Many of the buildings being demolished were working-class terraces and cottages, but few of the displaced tenants were offered alternative accommodation. According to a city alderman, the majority of them recognized that this sacrifice was essential for progress.
most of the workers were engaged locally, but many of the engineering and office staff made their way from England to work for Dorman Long's director of construction, Lawrence Ennis. One of them was Harry Crowe, who arrived without a job.
I applied for one or two jobs, but on the Sunday, that is the first Sunday that I was in Sydney, my brother took me down to the bridge site. And on the site, Mr. and Mrs. Ennis were there. It was their custom on a Sunday morning to stroll down from Macquarie Street, where they lived, to the bridge site to have a look round. And so I was introduced to the great Mr. Lawrence Ennis. He looked me up and down once or twice and said, well, Crowe, would you like a job on the bridge in the office? And I said, yes, sir. And he said, well, you've been on the ship for 6 weeks. How about starting tomorrow? But when I first got there, you see, it was 2.5 years since the contract had been signed, and I was a little disappointed. There was nothing much to see. The piers on the Dawes Point side were taking shape, but the unseen work had gone on largely at Milson's Point, where they'd built two large fabricating shops.
They were 500 feet long and up to 150 feet wide, huge by any standards. And they had to be for the fabrication of the steel sections and to house the confusion of heavy machinery needed for the task ahead. At full strength, 800 men were employed in the shops in three continuous shifts. Never before had Australia experienced such industrial activity. Ivan Stenson worked on various stages of the bridge, and there were a few lighter moments.
Yes, there was some amusing incidents, like one Christmas time, one of the chaps brought in some chooks to raffle, and he was a bit merry, and like a couple of the others was a bit merry too, and they got the some of the chooks and try to decapitate them with this heavy guillotine. This guillotine used to cut a piece of steel about 2 inches thick and about 8 feet wide in one go. Most of them got away and were flying all around the workshop, and it's a wonder that some of them weren't electrocuted on some of the wires that were around the place.
The entire weight of the steel span was to rest on massive bearings, two on each side of the harbour. The foundations for these were a mass of concrete 40 feet deep embedded in solid sandstone. Work progressed at a steady pace with only a few interruptions. The men on the site were among the highest paid in the Australian workforce, and the jobs were keenly sought. At first, Lawrence Ennis had some doubts about the local workers and their lack of major construction experience. It was a heavy responsibility to ensure that the hundreds of separate operations proceeded according to Ralph Freeman's plans. Many marveled at the way the project was coming together, like a giant jigsaw puzzle. Among them was Alan Cormack, a personal assistant to Ennis.
This would have been back right to the original designer in my mind. Sir Ralph Freeman must have had a mighty finger in the pie for that exactness. Must have done. It must work back to the designer. But also to the implementer, which was Ennis, with all his machinery, all his men, to see that the design was finally complete. His main big other job before the Harbour Bridge was only the Aswan Dam in Egypt, that was all. What a man.
But there was a long, hard road ahead before they could start congratulating themselves. By May 1928, Dorman Long started constructing the first of two creeper cranes, the largest ever built. They were necessary to build the arch, and within a year, the people of Sydney could begin to get an idea of what sort of structure would become a permanent part of their skyline. In the meantime, they were afforded a preview through newspaper photographs from overseas. Not far from where the silicon steel for Sydney was being rolled in Middlesbrough, King George V opened the Tyne Bridge at Newcastle in October 1928. Dorman Long, virtually on their home ground, were the contractors, and the construction period from start to finish was 3 years and 2 months. Although it was only a third the size of Sydney's and its erection scheme was not precisely the same, the Tyne Bridge was a valuable trial run for the company's big brother on the other side of the world. The British newspapers saw the opening of what they called the Rainbow Arch under the favour of royal presence as an event of national importance. Sydneysiders wondered if the King might come to open their bridge, but that was still 3.5 years away. Sydney's much larger Rainbow Arch, or coat hanger, as it would be known, would reach from either side of the harbour with the growing steelwork placed into position by the two creeper cranes on top. This could only be done by supporting the ever-increasing weight in some way until the two halves met in the middle and became self-supporting. As the steelwork could not be held up from below, it was decided to tie it back by steel cables anchored into rock tunnels on either side. Becoming more and more apparent day by day how the 38,000 tons of steel in the arch and the 6 million rivets were being used. Whether cooking rivets in vats of boiling oil or ramming them into position high in the sky, it was a job that called for the utmost precision and care. The safety measures were stringent in that age before hard hats, but there were the inevitable accidents. Clifford Anning, who worked on the arch, remembers the hazards of the job.
Particularly in high winds, you had to watch yourself, because one little blow and you're gone. And if it was raining at any time, well, we wouldn't work, of course, and down we'd come. There was one incident, I might tell you about the dangers of the job. One fellow was working just above us, or say about 20 feet away, might be 10 feet. We were underneath on a stage underneath talking about this job we had to rivet. And I just seen the thing go past me, and I thought it was a bag of bolts. And by the time we looked over, we'd just seen a splash, and then I heard commotion up above, and I just woke up that it must have been a man over. It took about a minute and a half, I suppose it might be between a minute and 2 minutes, he floated up again, in sight. He disappeared and then he came up again, you know. Well, it was too high to dive or anything like that, because a couple of hundred feet, we couldn't do anything, and the poor chap went. It was an Englishman named Addison. So that was the end of the job for the day. So we weren't off because you didn't feel like working when you see a mate go, you know.
Sydney Siders began to experience a surge of wonderment and pride as the two sections of the arch extended towards each other. Many of the artists of the time were captivated by the new industrial landscape evolving before their eyes. One of them was Lloyd Rees, who explains why the bridge was so attractive to painters.
Well, it's not a hard one to explain because although in one way a great structure like that was just the type of thing that artists wouldn't paint or draw because it was so huge and so demanding, but I think they were very conscious of an object that obeyed the laws of engineering and science to result in a thing of inevitable beauty. And it's rather interesting to think, in my view, that the most dynamic picture of the bridge was done by Grace Cossington Smith, a very gentle, quiet woman. But she did the bridge at its most pictorial stage, and that was before it was complete. Well, now, I had much more knowledge, if I might say so, of structure and that sort of thing, but I couldn't handle the bridge. Its scale was too enormous.
It was a tense moment when the two sections of the arch, now dwarfing the buildings on Circular Quay, were about to be joined. The anchorage cables had to be delicately slackened, and the two halves gently eased together and secured by massive guiding pins. The whole process occupied 2 weeks, as each day, the rise in temperature expanded the steelwork, and then it contracted during the night as temperatures fell. The lower cord was secured in August 1930. Sir Ralph Freeman travelled to Sydney to experience the triumphant moment with his father.
The contractor, Vaughan Long, wanted to keep this matter to himself until it was successfully done. I think that's understandable. But the next morning, well, there were lots of jollification, and there were all the usual whistle-blowing in the harbour, and everyone letting off steam, and everyone was highly delighted. I don't think there was any formal celebration. In fact, I'm sure there wasn't. But here, at last, was the arch finished, joined together, supporting itself.
As soon as the arch was complete, the creeper cranes were adapted to allow them to lift the cross girders and the 42 hangers of the bridge deck from pontoons on the harbour. Work began from the centre and extended back to the pylons. Thank you. speed that seems amazing, even by the standards of today's technology, the deck structure was completed by February 1931, and a long-awaited connection made between the two sides of the harbour. Most people in Sydney believed theirs was the greatest steel arch in existence. Greatest, yes, but longest, no. The Americans saw to it that the Bayonne Bridge between Newark, New Jersey, and Staten Island would appear in the record books as the world's longest. It was officially opened in November 1931, and a rumor circulated that a couple of feet had been added to the length of the span after the specifications for Sydney were drawn up and unable to be altered. And so, the Bayonne Bridge remains the longest steel arch, although it carries only road traffic and is not over a deep waterway. Neither Ennis, Freeman, nor Dr. Bradfield had any doubts about the safety of their masterpiece. But before being opened, it was given some exacting tests to simulate the worst possible load conditions. Dozens of locomotives and tenders converged on all four tracks over the center of the arch, and stress measurements were taken to prove that the bridge was in fine shape and not at all likely to fall down. Saturday, 19th of March, which had been declared a public holiday, dawned bright and warm. It was a good omen for what was to be the city's greatest day since Philip planted the flag of St. George and St. Andrew at Sydney Cove 144 years before. The opening was declared a state government occasion, and neither the Governor General nor the Prime Minister, let alone royalty, were invited to take an active part in the ceremony. The state governor, Sir Philip Game, officiated and was to read a message from the King, who was not pleased with the arrangements. Rosemary Harmer, the daughter of Sir Philip Game, remembers.
It was a very complicated business, and the plans came before my father. He came into tea one day and he said, I'll have to ask Lang to cut it down by half. There are going to be 9 speeches, and it's going to take 4 hours with 80 guns. And I said, we can't have 80 guns, because poor Mickey, which was our dog, would be terrified of all the bangs. Anyway, it was cut down and it was arranged, and finally everything was more or less settled, when a message came from the King to say that he wanted my father to open the bridge. And this was really rather a spanner in the works, because everything had been fixed by that time and difficult to alter. So after a lot of thought, my father cabled Buckingham Palace and asked very humbly if it might be left as it was, and that Mr. Lang could open it as they'd arranged, because to alter it would have been so complicated. And the cable came back from Buckingham Palace, and they said, yes, all right, it could be left and arranged. And so it was. But in 1934, when Father came home on leave, he went to a garden party at Buckingham Palace, and King George V spoke to him and said, quite severely, I wanted you to open the bridge.
The official proceedings went astray for a few moments when the New South Wales Premier was upstaged by the leader of a radical right-wing group called the New Guard, who wanted royalty to open the bridge. An Irishman named Captain Francis Edward de Groot burst forward and slashed at the ceremonial ribbon with his sword. He was immediately pulled from his horse and dispatched for psychiatric examination. The newsreels showing the incident were ordered to be censored. The Premier Jack Lang went ahead and officially opened the bridge, initiating a fortnight of celebrations whose splendor would not have disgraced Imperial Rome.
Of the feet, today's a holiday. Flags are flying everywhere, carnival is in the air, down old Sydney way. Bands are playing, here they come, listen to the big bass drum, listen to that hip hooray. When the planes up in the sky fly above the land so high, they're opening the bridge today. What does everybody say? The bridge we've been waiting for. Like a giant of steel, at last the dream is real. Doesn't it make you feel you love old Sydney more? Right across the dear old harbour, there's an ever-open door. Australia's sons, let us rejoice. It's the bridge we've been waiting for.
The great annual institution, the Royal Easter Show, is about to be held, and that, combined with the bridge euphoria, lulled many people into a state of optimism about the real world. But in March 1932, they were racing at Randwick, the Australian Jockey Club's carnival. New South Wales was playing South Australia in a four-day match at the Sydney Cricket Ground. And that unique symbol of Sydney's sybaritic existence, the surf carnival, was taking place in Bondi Beach. All of this, and the bridge, symbolised a faith in the future. Peter Sperrett again.
The opening day was certainly a euphoric day for Sydney, and estimates of up to 1 million people crossing the bridge that day. But we have to remember that when they went home that night, they were going home to the worst year of the Depression, probably the worst year in Australian history. The newspapers of the time ran cartoons like The Shadow Behind the Bridge to remind people that wasn't just going to keep going. Very shortly after the opening, most of the bridge workers were laid off. These are the men who'd given their lives for the last 5 or 6 years to build it, and there were no jobs for them. The dole queues were lengthening in Sydney.
After all the excitement of the opening had passed and the harsh realities of the economic situation were faced, the final cost of the project could be counted. There were 16 dead. In time, the planned 6 years' construction had extended to 8 because of early delays in land acquisition. The total bill had more than doubled to over £10 million when interest charges, land purchase and wage variations were taken into account. Dorman Long's expected profit was reversed into a stinging loss after the Australian currency was sharply devalued at the height of the world's depression. The contract made no provision for this. All of Dr. Bradfield's great claims for traffic flow had been based on the boom conditions of the 1920s, and it wasn't until 2 decades later, after another war, that the bridge was fully utilized. His vision of North Sydney becoming a twin metropolis did not begin to eventuate until the 1960s, when the bridge was already 30 years old. But these were only temporary setbacks. Right from the start, the project had an important symbolic role to play. It became, in effect, the National Trust.
Well, even while the bridge was still being built, it rapidly became the symbol for Australia, and this was certainly confirmed on completion. It was the Australian symbol. No other Australian capital had anything at all to match. In fact, of course, you find today that the bridge now has a bit of competition in the symbolic stakes, and it's joined by the Opera House and Centrepoint, for which, ironically, Dorman Long were one of the consulting engineers, and that other Australian cities just haven't got anything to match.
50 years is young for such a structure, and it can expect to have a useful life of at least a century, if not two. And long after future transportation patterns change its role, the bridge will remain, like its ancestor in Coalbrookdale, an impressive monument to human ingenuity.